There you go. All right. Making the best of things. Life is like that. How many people traveled in, I don't know, Asia, South Asia, India?
Yeah.
What? Yeah. You learn that, don't you? There, like, nothing goes, not nothing, but like a lot of things don't go as planned. And you get to deal with that.
Nothing is close enough.
Yeah. I don't want to say.
Yeah.
Nothing. And I'm sure it's better than in the 90s when I was there, but. Okay, so I think Ruben's going to turn up the heat. Does that sound good to people?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Too. Yeah. There are more blankets too.
Yeah,
get comfy. People must have been. It's too cold. I'm not leaving the house tonight.
It's so windy.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, we're gonna have snow, they said.
Wow.
Yeah, we might have snow on the mountain. I don't think the last time that happened was. I wonder when that was.
Take my laundry down.
I've seen it.
Oh. Good idea.
Take your laundry down. Snow or, you know, ice pellets, they said in the article. Something like that.
Tonight.
Hail. Not tonight, but. I think the wind is coming, but the rain might not come until tomorrow. Yeah, I read two different articles and they said two different things. You look at Apple weather, it didn't say rain tonight or tomorrow, I think. Just wind, if I'm not mistaken. But that's not that reliable about Apple, in my opinion.
Yeah.
You know? So, what I was thinking is, are we rolling?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, everybody. So, we're filming this because the streaming's not working, and then we'll post it a day after. So, apologies. And hello. We've been doing breathing, certain couple of breathing techniques in this class for the last few weeks. And I've explained the mindful expulsion, purification breath a few times. I don't know if all of you have been here for that. But I also have been introducing a form of breathing called the gentle base breath, which is a really wonderful practice that is kind of simultaneously foundational and accessible, but also advanced and meant to be done your whole life. So it's a really great thing to learn and to integrate into your life, but also your meditation practice. Course. Another word for it is the barlong, and bar you might find familiar is the same word that you see in Bardot, not Brigitte Bardot. Bardot. Bardot means the intermediary state. The intermediate state, and it can mean the intermediate state between one thought in the next, one breath in the next, one moment in the next, one phase of your life in the next, and then of course more well known is one life in the next. But there are actually said to be six bardos. There's like the waking bardo, there's the living bardo, there's the dying bardo, then there's the bardo after you've died, the intermediate state. That's the most popular one talked about. And then there's the becoming bardo. It's very interesting. So bar lung is a play on that word, bar, intermediate or in between space. It's like the space in between things, bar. And not the bar that you go have a drink at after work. That's a different in-between space. That's called happy hour. It's what you do before, after work and before this class, right? So, lung and bar lung means wind. Yet another great reason to talk about bar lung or jam lung. Because tonight, I don't know about you all out there in the ether, but in the Bay Area, it is very windy. Wind is called lung in Tibetan or prana in Sanskrit. And it also means vata in different forms of Sanskrit terminology pertaining to our health. So if you're familiar with Ayurveda, what they say, which is the ancient science of longevity from India, what they say is that when the wind element is out of balance, it's called vata. And vata dries the tissues, like you might feel your skin's mm-hmm. been dry lately, so it dries the skin, but also the internal, if you have vata in the body, it can dry the tissues internally, the joints, the bones get brittle. Mental, emotionally, it also has implications. You can feel spaced out. If you're kind of dominated by distraction in meditation, then both in Buddhism and in the Hindu tradition, they could say that you have a wind imbalance. So the vata is a bit, kind of, you know how the wind is always moving and it's unstable. It doesn't settle. So that can also be applied to the mind and your understanding of what you need to work with in terms of your meditation. So the bar lung, or the jam lung, so bar lung means intermediate breath. Jam lung, jam means soft, like jampa. Well, jampa literally also spelled differently means love. But jam also can mean soft. In Tibetan, when they say sweet dreams, they say soft dreams. They say semjin nango. Semjin nango. It means have soft dreams, have gentle dreams. So jam mung means soft or gentle breath. So it's meant to be gentle, not forceful. Okay? And you may recall we've done that after we've done the purification breath 9 times, then we settle and we rest. And I've been guiding you in inhaling and then retaining the breath at the hara, the navel center. So I want to explain that a little bit. But first, before I get too deep into that, I think, as always, let's do our opening prayer. And what we'll do tonight is, before we meditate, we will I will break it down. Okay, I'm going to break down that breath pattern and explain it to you, and you can ask some questions if you have them, and then we'll do it again, and then we'll go into meditation after we've done it a second time. Okay? Does that sound clear? Have you been here before? I don't mean to put you on the spot. That's right, you look familiar. Yes. Yeah, nice to
it's
see you again.
It's been a little while.
Yeah, welcome back. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sorry if you feel lost. Pretty much everybody here's been coming consistently, and that's up.
That's totally new people. Fine. Yeah. It wouldn't be the first time lost in meditation practice.
Awesome. That's a good attitude. That's making peace with vata. Lost is a quality. Cool. Okay, let's not go a moment further without honoring Goddess Narayani. How many times would you like to chant it tonight? 3, 7, 11, 21, 108, 54, 21. Cook it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that sound good?
Mm-hmm.
It's just not that long.
What? I love the number 21.
Don't you love it?
I always love the number
21.
It's a good number.
It's such a great number.
Is today the 21st?
It is. Today is the 21st. Oh, also happy New Year. This is Lunar New Year in the Tibetan lunar calendar, and it's called Losar, New Year. Low is year, sar is new, and so it's a holy day, and this is a very auspicious time to do practice. It's also a great time to clean your house and clear out all the negative energy. And it's also Mardi Gras. Did you see the new moon and the two planets? Do you know, what are those planets up there?
I don't know, but I did see them.
Yeah, I'm hoping Venus and Jupiter, I'm thinking, for personal reasons. But those ones usually shine bright in those spaces. Okay, so Happy New Year. So let's do 21. So make can pray to Narayani to also take away all of our afflictions, particularly those pertaining to vata imbalance. You know, may our energy be balanced, our meditation concentration be solid and stable. May our joints be juicy, our skin and our body feel good. As we are kind of transitioning into spring, it's a good time from winter to spring to respect the air element of vata inside and out. But what I didn't finish is the thought of when prana, when energy or when the wind is in balance, it's called prana. So that's what we're working with. We're working with prana, the lung. We're balancing the prana through the bar lung or jam lung. Those are synonyms. Okay. So when the wind element is out of balance, what's it called? When it's in balance, what's it called?
Prana.
Good. And so the spiritual life, the spiritual practice is about, is balancing, you could say purifying or harmonizing the wind, the vata, releasing excess vata, they would say in Ayurveda, and bringing that balanced wind towards the core of the body. Remember, after we do the 9 purification breath, I say now rest in wisdom prana. That's the balance expression of the wind element, right? And that's the centralized experience of the prana coming into your central channel. So that's really when prana's activated and utilized for spiritual awakening. When prana is more at the extremities, it's called the karmic wind, and that's more vata. And when it's more towards the core of the body, like in the central channel, it's called the wisdom wind. Narayani, please help us understand and experience this. She's a refuge of all of those downtrodden in the cycle of suffering, samsara, aka survivor show. You're joking that like samsara is kind of like being on Survivor. So she's also the very act of turning towards the Supreme. So we'll just jump in. Take some deep breaths, close your eyes. Sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane sarvasya jihare devi narayani namosute Sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane sarvasya jihare devi narayani namostute sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane sarvasya jihare devi narayani namostute sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane sarvasya jihare devi narayani namostute sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane sarvasya jihare devi narayani namostute
Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute. Sharanagata Dinata Parijana Parayane Sarvasya Tayare Devi Narayani Namostute.
A few minutes of the Ganesh, so you don't forget. It's Om Gam Ganapatiye Namaha. Repeat after me. Om Gam Ganapatiye Namaha. Om Gam Ganapatiye Namaha. Namaha. Good. Kevin, maybe move the video a little closer because I don't talk very loud. I'm so join in when you're ready. Ganesh is also a good deity to pray to at the beginning of any endeavor. Om Gam Ganapataye Namaha. 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 Om Gam Ganapataye Namaha.
Ganapataye Namaha. Om Gam 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 Ganapataye Namaha.
And let's stand up. Okay, do the quick in. We'll do 8 reps this time tonight, each direction. Heels kissing, toes slightly turned out. Right hand on the belly, left hand on top. Reach up through the crown of the head. And with the exhalation, relax the weight of the body into the soles of the feet. Feel the feet relax against the floor. As you inhale, feel the breath rooting down into the floor, apana vayu, the downward wind, rooting the in-breath. And with the exhalation, prana vayu, the upward wind. This is another way of understanding the winds in the body. Grow up and out through the crown of the head, the out-breath. Inhale down into the feet, rooting, and exhale, release, blooming, up and out. 3 more like that. Inhale, feel the belly expand with the breath, chest lifted. Exhale, releasing up and out through the crown of the head. Inhale, rooting down through the soles of the feet into the earth. And exhaling, releasing the prana up to the heavens. 1 more. Good. Now release the hands from the navel, feet parallel, right foot back. And outward spiral. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Reverse. 1, 2. Hands are down by your side. 5, 6, 7, 8. And 1, 2, 3. I would say like either be totally off or totally on. Either one. Yeah, and don't step on the mantras, girlfriend. It's all right, you didn't get that memo. 2, reverse. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and flat. Now we come up to the head. Exhale, release the chin down to the right. We'll do 4 reps. Each direction, up and around. 1, 2, relaxing tension from the jaw, the face, the neck. 3, the shoulders. Feel the breath still in the feet, your awareness in the feet as you move the upper body, rooting. And then reverse. 1, 2, 3, 4. Coming to center. Inhale, face to neutral. Looking forward at an angle towards the floor. Shoulders forward, up, down, and back. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and reverse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Wrists. 1, double time. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Reverse. 1, 2, 3, 4. Relax the ridge of the shoulders. 7, 8. Spiral to the right. 1, 2, 3. Let the head move. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Again. 1, 2, 3. And let the hips move, or you can keep them static, whatever feels better for the back. 7 and 8. Hips. 1, 2, 3, 4. Feet are hip width distance apart, a little wider. Yeah. Good. 7 and 8. And reverse. Let the whole upper body be really relaxed. Good. 2, 3, 4. 6, 7, and 8. Come to center. Feet together. Bend the knees forward. Rest the hands above the knees. Circle the knees. 1, 2, 3. Relax the shoulders. 5, 6, 7, 8. Good. Reverse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Inhale, feet hip width distance apart. Exhale, sarpa, the wave, the snake. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Eight. Inhale, raise the arms, look up, chin down, hold the breath in, then move the hands, exhale as the hands pass in front of the face, pressing the energy down through the core of the body into the soles of the feet. 2 more, like that. Inhale, you're practicing your kumbhaka, your base breath, holding in retention. Hold it. Exhale as the hands pass in front of the face. Into the earth. Again, inhale, rooting,
holding, exhale. The hands are weighting down, rooting into the earth, but you can let prana flow up through the crown of the head. Good. Now one more time. Inhale into the feet, chin down, hold the breath, waving down. Now exhale. As the hands pass in front of the heart, you bring the back of the hands together. Then the heel toe a little closer together, squatting, standing on top of the hands. The arch of the feet are right on the tops of the hands. Good. Inhale here. And exhale completely. Your next in-breath, Kaki Mudra, pucker the lips, breathe in through the mouth, inhale. Exhale, close the mouth, breathe out through the nose. Press the tongue against the upper palate, right at the root of the front teeth. And inhale, pucker, Kaki, through the mouth. Press the tongue at the frenum. Breathing into the anus, and then exhale through the nose. Press the tongue at the top of the teeth on the hard palate, and inhale, Kaki, last time, inhale. Close the mouth, exhale, relax everything. Breathe out through the nose. Inhale off the hands, Uttanasana, standing forward fold, extend through the spine, and then exhale, bow the forehead, and then inhale, bend the knees, roll up one vertebrae at a time, step the feet hip width distance apart, either on or off your pillow, it's up to you, inhale. We'll do some horse stance just to get the heat in the body, the inner heat. Inhale, open the circle. Exhale, hands to the navel. Hold that ball of chi here. Elbows a little wider. Space beneath the armpits. Relax the soles of the feet. Yeah, trust the legs here. Find your bones. Inhale into the feet. Exhale. And let the eyes be open, gazing at a comfortable angle towards the floor. The face is soft. Keep breathing naturally. Inhale. Tailbone is heavy. Don't let the hips push back too much. The hips are right under the shoulders. Shoulders are relaxed. Notice if the shoulders are holding tension. Yeah, see if you can stay. Mm-hmm. Good. Notice if the feet are gripping. Relax the toes. Exhale, but stay in the bend. Bring the hands down. Then inhale. Turning the palms forward. Exhale. Gaze between the fingers. What do you project into the world? Inhale. What do you take in? Exhale. Circle, heels forward, just for a moment here. You can come on your fingertips or the palms, gently though, not a lot of weight. Look forward, it's called chakra mandala. Hips are down, come on you guys, get in your legs, it won't kill you. I know you're gonna hate me, but you'll like me when you sit in your meditation so you'll feel better. Good. And then inhale, hug the elbows around the ankles a little bit. Look straight down now this time. A couple more breaths. Breathe into the feet. Stay with the heat. It's good heat. And let that heat melt into the bone marrow. Then inhale, heels come wide, hands come off the floor, come up to standing. Liberation. This is what liberation, nirvana feels like. Exhale. Down there was samsara. This is nirvana. Work your breath here, hold it, and then exhale. Again, last time, inhale, look up. Exhale. Step together. Exhale, concluding this. And then keep bending the knees, come down to seated. So now we're going to do our breath work. Leg work, by the way, is another way to get the vata in the body to get balanced or off gas, you know, and turn into prana. So, leg work. We can get more into that later. That's more yogic stuff. So, this is our breathing before we do the sitting. So if you can do lotus, or sitting in chair is good. Either way, or a comfortable cross-legged position, or zazen, however you like. I'll do lotus because that's how I learned it. But please don't push to do this if it's not comfortable for you. So we'll do the 9 purification breaths. And you've learned that already. What I want to talk about now for the moment is the gentle base breath. Essentially what we're doing is we're packing the prana in the body. And we're packing it down into this kumbha. This is called the kumbha, or the vase. It's the hara. Particularly, if you put your finger into your navel and then count 4 finger widths below the navel and press in from there, you can do it yourself. Right in there and right into the center of the pelvis is your hara, is that nabi, the center of your own personal mandala, right? That's the center of your being, more or less. And that's where the 2 side channels in the subtle body anatomy of both tantric Buddhist and Hindu yoga, the side channels kind of hook out of the central channel right at that point, 4 finger widths below the navel. So, why is that important? Well, normally in our karmic winds, in the karmic action day of right, wrong, day, night, black, white, male, female, binary, we're abiding in the 2 side channels. That's what the yogis say. They say liberation doesn't happen during the day and the night. And what that means is code word, or called twilight language, the twilight language, code language for liberation doesn't happen when you're stuck in duality. Mm-hmm. So yoga is about getting, coaxing, coercing, tricking the prana, the karmic winds of duality, the mind, whatever we want to feel it, back into the central channel, like make the wind go back home. The central channel is that bulb at the base of the spine, right in front of the spinal column. It's like a narcissist bulb, and then it grows up straight-ish up, and then blooms into the hopefully not narcissistic 1,000-petaled lotus flower at the crown of the head. Whereas the 2 side channels come out, run parallel, more or less, depending on the system. And they don't terminate at the flower, they terminate at the 2 nostrils. That's why we do pranayama, you know, both in the hatha yoga, maybe you've learned different kinds of pranayama, nadi shodhana, kapalabhati, these other types of breath of fire practices. They're playing with it's not nose torture. They're actually playing with the 2 side channels here by opening one, closing the other. It can balance the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous systems. They've done studies on that too. So that's why this point right here below the navel, 4 finger widths and in, is very important, because that is the juncture where the winds enter the central channel and we experience samadhi. So when we're packing the prana down into the hara, we're doing that because we're coaxing the prana into that area so that it gets sucked into the central channel and we experience samadhi. So that's the reason why I'm doing this, why I learned it, and why I'm teaching it to you, is we do this breath work where we inhale. I'll talk you through it. You can don't quite do it formally yet. You inhale, it can be a 3, 4, 5 count, whatever's comfortable for your body. Usually we do 5. And then when you're full, you hold the breath in. If you can, you swallow. And that helps to pack the prana downward. You hook the chin a little bit to kind of close the upper door. You lift the lower doors, the perineal floor, like try it now, like that feeling is, try not to pee, you know? Like, oh, feel that, but then it's like, it's not forceful, it's just 5%, it's very subtle, but the lower doors close. You know, women have 3, men have 2 doors, women have 3 because we're better. But, you know, those are called the lower doors, you know, another Twilight language code word. So it's like we're, in a sense, we're closing those lower doors so that the prana doesn't leak out, so that we're not, we become the vase, we become the vessel, okay? So we inhale, that's all happening on the inhale. Hold it, swallow if you can, don't stress if you can, it's a little hard at the beginning. But you can do the chin, closing the upper door, passageway. Lift the perineum, close the lower doors. Can you feel that? Okay, when you do that just a little bit, do you feel a little, they say it's like a little bit of bliss. You might not feel it's okay if you don't feel it, but that they say that's the bodhicitta, the essence drops of tigle, bindu moving through the channels in the body. So you might get a little feeling of tingling or pleasure, that's that lifting. So you've closed the upper and the lower, and that's not all. Then I'll remind you to then soften the belly out, like, yes, like a beach ball. Just unlearn all the cultural learning you've learned about trying to have a flat six pack. Let it be full. They say a true yogi has a nice little beach ball belly, or yogini. And so that's all on the in-breath. And then when you exhale, you can keep the lower door closed if it feels good, or you can totally relax that. Eventually, you're working towards maintaining that lower door. But the upper door will open, the belly will, you know, it might stay somewhat out, but you're not focusing so much on it. So what we do is we do, say, 5 count in breath, 5 count breath retention, where we're really concentrating on packing the prana into that hatha space, coercing it into the central channel, and then exhale slowly like silk, okay? And last note about the exhalation, we don't exhale completely empty. We exhale till about 20-30%, and then we fill it back up again. That's another way to pack it in. So this is a longevity practice. This is said to help build the prana in the body, which helps to build that's the life force. So it's longevity, it brings more balance and health to the system, radiance to the skin, more ease of mind, and it sets us up for meditation. So you want to try a few rounds, then you can ask questions? Okay. So let's just do the vase breath. An in breath and exhale completely. Then let's all inhale. Hold the breath when you're full. If you can, swallow. Chin slightly down. Lower doors close. Lifting slightly. And then soften the belly out if you can. Hold it, feel the mind rooting down to the hara, and then gently exhale. Keeping a little bit there at the bottom of the vase, and inhale again, filling. holding, swallow, chin, perineal floor, belly soften. It's a little like juggling. It's okay. In the beginning, it might not come easy. It takes time. Please hold it lightly. Don't pressure yourself. Holding, inhale retention, relax the mind, and then exhale. Inhale, one, two, three, four, five, holding, swallow, chin, perineal floor, belly softens. Feel the prana circulating at the hara, like you're filling the vase of prana, mind, awareness, attention. Then exhale, one, two, three, four, five. One more like this. Inhale, one, two, three, four, five, holding, one, two, three, four, five, exhale, one, slow, silky exhale, four, and five, and relax and breathe naturally for a few moments. Relax all control of the breath. Okay, open your eyes. Any questions? Yes.
So I have no idea if I was doing it right. But at one of the breaths, I think it was the second to last one, I started feeling something like here.
The solar plexus.
Yeah, or like it was maybe a little higher than that. It felt more like in that, and it was a very weird feeling.
Okay, like warm, cold, tight, uncomfortable.
No, it was a good feeling.
Oh.
But I don't know if that's.
Yeah, you might have. When you say good, maybe give me a couple more adjectives, like warm, good,
well,
pleasurable.
Well, it felt like it was kind of going upwards.
Uh-huh. Okay.
It was more like a lightness.
Yeah, good. Maybe you were having a release. Sometimes that can happen when you're doing this breath. Some energy releases and it can feel pleasurable or feel good. Yeah, so just observe that. Just feel it, notice it, note it, but stay with the technique and keep going with it. That's good. Yeah, it's a sign that you're starting to move some energy there. Unlock your energetic potential, you know? Because we all have these knots of energy, and when we liberate them, we have more prana. We have more access to the prana. Okay? Do you have any questions about, in terms of doing it right, you know, like, were you feeling like, is there anything I can help you with in terms of feeling more?
I almost feel like I need like an animation or something of the belly.
Uh-huh.
You know, like to show what exactly is the emotion.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes I'll talk about this, I don't know if it helps you, but like if you in your mind do this animation where you have like a vase, right? And at the base is more of the larger, rounder place. So as you're breathing in, imagine that you're pouring the vase full of water and it's filling from the bottom, middle to the top. Then when you're holding, you're full. And then you're like letting that vase, that bulb, soften. And I feel it softening forward, but then I also have to remember to soften back. So remember also, let the kidneys soften back. Somebody online asked that, like, what does that mean, soften the kidneys towards the floor? And what I mean is that when we're tense in the low back, we're jutting the chest forward and we're overarching the back. And that can cause all sorts of blocks in the back and discomfort. And then you're kind of like distended or too far forward in the front. So when I say relax the kidneys back and down, which is what we're thinking also when we're holding the breath and doing this breath, is that you're not pushing them forward towards the front of the body. You're letting them soften back, even feel that. Like a little bit more sitting back on your sits bones and then dropping the kidneys, which are right at the lower bottom ribs. They're right back there. Yeah. So that's the other thing you can think about, is when you're breathing in, you're filling from the base to the top, and then you're holding, and rather than being like this, you're relaxing the kidneys back and down, okay? While you're letting the belly come forward. So it's like you're inhabiting the whole torso, the base, the pelvic hole here. And then when it's, So while you're doing that 5 second kumbhaka, and that will grow, you can do that longer. The kumbhaka means the vase, it's you're holding in. Then it's like literally what, I don't know if I made this up or if the teacher said this, you know how we can conflate things sometimes, but it works for me, so I remembered it, which is, you can imagine that you're placing your mind, your head even, into the belly, and you're abiding in the belly, like you are no longer the head person, you are the belly person. And your consciousness, your awareness is in the belly, and you're building that capacity to be operating and meditating and moving through your life from the hara. So you're relaxing your awareness down into the belly. It's soft, you've closed the lower doors. You're sealing, you're making a seal. Seal from below, seal from above. And then as you exhale, you can open that upper door and let the breath out. And then the image is that you're pouring water out of the vase. So when you pour water out of the vase, how does it leave? It leaves from the top, from the middle. And then the bottom is the last empty. But it doesn't, in this breath, it doesn't completely empty. Even just starting to think about that, move towards that intention is good enough. I know, I do think we need some Pixar people to get into Vajrayana, because that would be really cool. I don't think anybody would have, like any of the lamas would have a problem with that. We should do that. There's so many cool visualizations, you know, spinning mantra, rainbow light, you know, you could do all sorts of cool stuff. But also breathing, yoga can be helpful to see. Yeah. Anyone else? How does that feel? Any questions? There's no bad questions.
It just felt like my breath was a little shallow, like it was hard for me to breathe in for the whole time.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, it can take, normally it's easier, like when we're learning in the beginning, we do shorter in-breath and longer out-breath. So if that works for you, you can do that too. So if my counting isn't working, don't sweat it. It might be easier for you to hold longer than what I'm counting. And if not, that's okay too. Just work at your own pace. But over time, you'll build more capacity. It's you can, technically, I mean, some teachers say do the ujjayi breath where you're constricting the root of the throat to slow down the breath. And you can do that if you know that yogic breathing from more of the hatha yoga tradition. You can bring that into this to help you slow it down. It helps slow it down. And with intentionality and practice, it just becomes more natural to do a longer, slower breath. You know, it's true that the shorter in-breath and the longer out-breath really helps to calm the nervous system. Like if somebody's having kind of an anxiety attack, or if you can't sleep at night, a wonderful tool is to breathe a natural in-breath. And then if you can, double the length of the out-breath. So that is something you can work with. With this particular breathing, we're working equal. Inhale, equal holding, equal exhale. There's all sorts of different ways to breathe. Yeah, I think it will just come with time. And that feeling of having it be three parts, of filling from below, middle to top, can also help you stretch out the breath. Anyone else?
On the first, I found that it works well, except that my body has difficulty having soft belly and constricted like lower.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, this isn't that bad. And then I tried to do soft belly and was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Now there's like a lot of things happening at once, so I'm sure it will come with time, but it was just like, okay. Maybe the belly won't be that soft right now.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's I find that I found that hard in the beginning too, and even if I haven't done it for a while, it's like, oh, can I do both? Because these muscles are connected, you know, and so the lifting is a bit of a tightening, but then like letting out, it also wants to bottom out, you know.
It feels like I have to learn a dance move where,
yeah,
like one part of my body is moving one direction and another moving the other,
exactly,
at the same time.
Yeah. So a couple of things, like in the last few weeks, I actually haven't emphasized lifting of the perineum first. Sometimes it's helpful to lift the perineum last. But the way classically it was taught was close the upper door, the lower door, then relax out. So that's the classic way. But some people find it easier to close the upper door, soften the belly, and then once you've got the belly soft, which is, you know, sort of new and maybe to some of us, once you've got that happening, then kind of tickle the lower door. Like, can I start to close the lower door? Yeah. And that's actually how I kind of came to it. That's how it started to help work a little bit better for me. So you can try to
do an experiment.
Either top, bottom, middle. That's a classic way. I mean, when I say top, I mean top. Or you can do sort of the innovative way, which is top, middle, bottom steps. Were you able to swallow?
I struggled.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I was confused.
Some people could.
Where's the swallowing?
Yeah, at the top of the in-breath. So it's like.
Okay. It's hard to keep the top closed and swallow.
So don't close until after you swallow. So inhale. I just swallowed, now I can swallow. You know, it's like one of those things, like when you think about too much, you can't do it. Then chin comes down. So then you packed it, and what the feeling is with the swallow and then the chin second. So swallow first, inhale first, you know what I mean? Swallow second, chin third, either perineum fourth or belly fourth, either one, flip flop. And what's nice about these steps at the beginning are that they help to pack the energy. The feeling is that you're packing. We live so much up here. Too much. Too much. I will say that with total conviction. So we're like, please, we're turning down and we're paying homage to the other parts of ourselves that get ignored. And we're packing that energy and saying, hello. Can I live down there for a bit and build that? So that whole swallow thing helps to pack it. Lift it. I feel like a
bop it.
Yeah, that's what that is. Well, what is that?
Twist it.
Was
bop
like
it. Thing. I think it's called bop it.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
Yeah, bop it. Oh my god.
Oh my god. What?
Childhood.
Bop it. That's what the game is called. Bop it.
Do the same.
Kids love that. My oldest loved that one. You're probably around my oldest kids. They are 22 now. They did the bop it. Exactly. Just bop it.
That's the next level of this practice.
That's the next level. Then you start bopping.
Bop
it. Yeah. Or like with the well, what's funny is that there's a practice called Nelbop, which means, well, that's different. Nelbop is to totally relax, but bop in Tibetan means to fall. And there's have you seen the YouTube video of the yogis, the Tibetan yogis, who will, they'll jump up off their zabutan and in midair go into lotus and land on their base, you know, the whole area.
Demonstrate.
I tried. I did a whole program where we just spent a year doing Tibetan yogas, and some people could do this. I have low back issues, so I had a good excuse not to do that. But some people could do it. You jump up, crazy, and that's called bop. So in a way, yes, that is the next. That is the next step.
Yeah.
Okay, so when you get home tonight or tomorrow morning when you're having your coffee, if you can remember, oh yeah, Chandra said to look on YouTube, Tibetan yoga, what would they call it in English? You say flying, but it's called B-A-B, or some people spell it B-A-P. And you'll pretty quick, you'll see Tibetan yoga. Tummo. It's a practice with the inner heat. It's what gets the, it's Kundalini yoga. It's hardcore Himalayan Kundalini yoga, which is meaning we don't do things in the like slow, smooth way. We're up here in the freezing cold. We're going to get the heat to build really fast. So we're going to do more extreme, hardcore stuff. And the bop is one of those things. They say that when you land, not just on the tailbone, but on the whole thigh, buttocks region, it undoes the knots in the central channel and in the channels, and it opens up the kundalini and it gets it to rise through the central channel. So Tummo, T-U-M-M-O, you could look for Tummo, and then you might see some of the bop. These guys doing the bops. They wear these cute little skirts, maybe these little rainbow yogi skirts. Other strange circles that you frequent. And I will not ask you to do that, I promise. You know, I will not teach anything that I myself have not tested out, I swear. It's a great practice and it's helped a lot of people, but it has also hurt a lot of me. I'm like, we can do that in other ways. I don't live up in my Kailash. Nine purification breaths, then we'll do the breathing for a while, and then we'll meditate, okay? So, take a comfortable cross-legged position. And just so you know, I'm teaching it in a more introductory way, which is with the palms face down. But another way to do it, if you like it, and if the proportions of your body allow you to hold this shape comfortably, you can do what you've learned already with the nine purification breaths, which is the Vajra fist, the thumb at the root of the ring finger, curling around, back of the hand. And you can do those practices, the gentle face breath with the arms like this. That's the classic also. Kind of, you know, you could say more intermediate advanced way. Okay? So I'll give you that option when we come to it. You, by all means, if you've got tendonitis, if you've got wrist issues, if you have a super short torso and really long arms, it might be hard for you to do. Everybody's got their own anatomy they have to respect and love. So just do what feels good to you. Okay, so take a few breaths. And bop it. No, I'm kidding. If you need to, if this is new to you, inhale, you can watch me if you need to. Raise the arms overhead. Then exhale, bringing heaven to earth as you make your Vajra fists. Place the back of the hands at the root of the crease of the hips. Straighten through the elbows if you can. Inhale, the left arm out, circle. Place the left index on the left nostril. Exhale through the right nostril, purifying that right channel. Empty, you begin to release the hand to the hip. Inhale, right arm. Imagine you're breathing in rainbow light, filling every cell of the body. Exhale, your left channel. Elbow parallel with the floor, palm forward. Releasing down. Again, inhale the left arm. Rainbow light filling the body, filling the cells of the body. Place, exhale, cleansing that right channel a little more cleansed. You can imagine a smoky vapor leaving the nostrils with each exhalation. Other side, inhale. Rainbow light. Place it. As you breathe out, that smoky vapor turns into nectar and feeds all those beings, Lord Yama, Lord of Death, karmic debtors in your life, to complete satisfaction. Inhale, other side. Last time, left arm, circle once with the wrist. Exhale, completely cleansing that right channel, feeding all those beings that you may have karmic debts with to complete satisfaction so they don't come knocking at your door. Inhale. Exhale, completely cleansing the left channel. Facing it. Inhale, both hands stay down. Three-part exhalation, cleansing the central channel. Smoky, a little less smoky, completely clear central channel. Inhale, release the hands, then palms down, resting in wisdom prana. And feel that vase, feel the belly starting to soften already. Feel the kidneys releasing down and back. The whole belt line is soft. You're creating that space for the breath to fill. Let's just take a few breaths with this feeling of inhaling, filling the vase from the bottom to the middle to the top. We're not doing anything else. Just that feeling of filling with the in-breath and then pouring out with the out-breath, from the top, middle, to the base. Two more, inhale, just filling. Exhale, pouring. And the ujjayi, the gentle constriction of the base of the throat can help here. Inhale, slowly. Exhale, pouring. Good, now we'll begin. If you want to take the vajra fists and straighten the elbows, you can, or just keep the hands on the thighs. Just do what feels good for you. Let's inhale and exhale completely to get ready. Inhale. Hold the breath, swallow if you can, chin down next. Lift the perineal floor, relax the belly. Holding the breath in, feel your awareness abiding in the belly. And then exhale, you can lift the chin a little to open the upper door. And let the breath smoothly flow out, emptying the vase. Not completely though. Inhale, turn back around, refill it slowly. Holding, swallow, chin, perineal floor, belly soften. It'll come, just be soft. Don't let any tension build in the system. Stay relaxed. Exhaling slowly. Again, inhale. You can lift the chin a little bit to let the air in. And when full swallow, chin down, pack the energy down, lift at the perineal floor, belly soften out, kidneys soften back, hold it. Now feel like your head is down in your hatha. And then exhale, releasing the chin a little bit, breathing out. Do some more like this. I'll start to count, but if the counting doesn't work for you, just let it go and breathe at your own pace. Inhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, holding, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, exhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, inhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, holding, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, exhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, inhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, hold in, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, exhale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, inhale last time, 2, 3, 4, 5, hold in, 1, 2, 3, 4, hold it a little longer, hold it a little longer, sip in the breath a little more, there's a little, you can sip it, hold it, sip and hold, pack it, sip it, pack it, don't laugh. Giggle, then inhale, sip it, and back it down. Lift the perineal floor. Sip again. I'm not kidding, this is a technique. Sip it. And then exhale. Sounds like you're smoking a joint, maybe. Inhale, release the hands if they're up. Exhale, palms down. Breathe naturally, release any control of the breath. So we'll sit for about 12 minutes, so make sure you're comfortable. So feel yourself gliding into meditation, this natural state, so much perhaps more easy to find after the breathing, or to just abide in. This natural feeling of spaciousness permeating your awareness. Within that spaciousness, the quality of stability. The mind wanders, gently bring it back. Maybe even bring it back to the hatha, that feeling of warmth, openness in the belly. Let that be your anchor tonight. You feel the warmth of the hara gently coaxed into this feeling of the central funnel within you, the central channel. That inner heat. Breathe in an inner light, our inner warmth. Let that spread throughout your body, if it's there. bring our practice to a close now. If you wish, bring your hands to your heart, Anjali Mudra, the thumbs gently tucked in between the palms, symbolizing the jewel in the heart of the lotus, our Buddha nature within the lotus of our life, rising up from the muck of samsara and blooming into the beautiful flower of Buddhahood. And with this prayer, this mudra, imagine that we offer up any positive energy that we've cultivated tonight as a Sangha in our practice for the benefit of all beings everywhere. And in that offering, it becomes limitless. You can imagine or feel that you're dedicating to specific groups or people, beings, places. That they be well and free of suffering. Another way to soothe the wind element in the body is to do self-massage, is touch, basically. You know, weighted blankets, physical touch, self-massage, other, you know, being with another, being with yourself. But also oil, like sesame oil is a good universal one. You can, it's not that expensive. You can massage it into your skin and get in the shower or the bath. Careful not to slip, or if you have a steam shower or access to a sauna, oil the body and the skin before you go into those spaces, and that can help. It's kind of like seals the warmth and the good energy, the prana, into the body, and helps to moisturize the tissues, moisturize the skin, the joints. That's a common therapeutic practice in Ayurveda, and you can do it at home. Ayurveda has a lot of really great home remedies. And if you're curious to learn more about how you can do stuff like that at home, Ayurvedic practices, the Wise Earth School of Ayurveda is a beautiful resource. And it was founded by a very cool woman named I guess they call her, it's not Amaji, there's another Ama, I'm blanking on her name. Mother Maya, they call her Mother Maya. But look up Wise Earth Ayurveda, and she has all sorts of podcasts and little teachings on how to make different teas or tinctures or do self-massage, make simple home remedies that are accessible. So look up anything she has to say about calming vata during these times. I'm bringing this up because of the wind, you know. A good time to stay cool, stay close to the earth, to calm the inner wind as much as possible. Thank you, everybody. Have a good night. Thanks for rolling with the punches here. Thanks, Ruben, for spearheading the, I don't know who else maybe was helping too, but thanks for trying to make this container warm. And we'll figure out where the bell went. I hope.
It's locked in Katie's office.
Okay, good. Of course.
Liz just came into the office now.
When?
Oh, another. I'll save it for another.
Yeah, time. Okay. Was that a joke?
No.
Oh.
We can't get into the office because
right.
It's locked and there's no key for it.
I know,
so
we need Hannah. Where's Hannah? In the newsletter today.
Yeah,
Katie said Hannah would be. But maybe that's during the daytime. Be here on Tuesdays through Thursdays. I was like, oh, good. Hannah's going to be here. But. Maybe not in the evening. Hannah's the new operations director.
Oh, great.
Yeah, she seems wonderful. What did you say?
I just saw her this evening, but she's coming in tomorrow, so.
Oh.
I don't know if she's usually not here on Tuesdays.
Yeah, maybe I misread. I think, you know, Katie's like, she'll be here from Tuesdays to Thursdays every week. So is that 9 to 5? We don't know. But she was here at last class. It's nice to have her here and meet her. But in any case, I'll see you next week. Take care. Enjoy some tea. Hopefully that's working. If you want. It might not be warm.
I plugged it in.
No, you plugged it in. Good. It takes a village.
I did.
Yeah.
No, everything was kind of hiding today.
Yes.